A strong health system lies at the core of building a country that has a healthy population, vigorous society, and strong economy. Derisory health system has unbalanced and crippling effects on the growth of developing nations. Studies have shown that developing and least developed countries are the most susceptible and at least equipped to deal with the burden of diseases such as malaria, tuberculosis, HIV and AIDS, and other contagious tropical diseases. This anecdote is an inquiry into the health system challenges of the West African nation, Liberia's most populated county. The research delves into two core issues, access and quality. With access to health, we look at the availability and capacities of health facilities, availability of medication, location and ease of access to health facilities, cost of health services including availability of health insurance, and available training facilities and healthcare workers. For quality, the documentary delved into viable health equipment, qualification and competence of health workers, pay and incentives for health workers, training materials and methodology, drug quality and community participation in health decision. This investigation was commissioned just before the heydays of the Ebola outbreak in Liberia. It was stalled and repositioned to capture Ebola as the outbreak predominantly spoke directly to the issues under inquiry.
But health system six building blocks that are very, very much everything have to work within the six building blocks for you to have a vital and good health system. Your human resource for health have to be adequate. You have to make sure that the services for the people, maternal, newborn, child health services, the public health well-being of the population have to be there. Health is not just disease. Health is also the mental, emotional well-being of the population. How healthy the population is critical. Health infrastructure is also there. Equipment and technology, drugs and medical supplies. These are the combination of what make a health system.
The National Health Infrastructure Policy, NHIP, was developed in response to the challenges created by the Civil War that destroyed about 95% of health infrastructure. The NHIP has six main objectives. To establish well-defined building standards for all health facilities and to ensure compliance with the standards based on the local conditions. To establish a transparent project delivery management system. To define health infrastructure components. To define roles and responsibilities of the infrastructure unit and all involved stakeholders. To establish a process of regular management, monitoring, maintenance, and evaluation of all health facilities. And to ensure collaboration and coordination of the NHIP among all health infrastructure stakeholders and the National Health Policy and Plan 2011 to 2021.
We are looking at the health infrastructure and redesigning them to suit infection prevention and control activities and to be able to also isolate where needed. So that is also currently ongoing and it will roll into the future. We are also looking at our plan calls for a certain number of health facilities to complete the network of health facilities to provide access to health care within our 1 hour walk, for example. And so we are also looking at health infrastructure for that.
Look at what happened during the Ebola crisis. It showed you that we're not prepared for a disease like Ebola, because what we're not doing a triage system. And so our health facilities were not built for that. So now those are, you know, it's a lesson learned that, look, we had this situation now, we got to build our infrastructure, we got to re-engineer our infrastructure.
Montserrado County has 204 health facilities, but are they sufficient per citizens? Are there adequate health workers to cater to the caseload?
The overall number of healthcare workers, you wouldn't believe, there are something like 8,000 plus all over the country that are public health facilities workers. You add to that another close to 2,000 in private facilities run by churches and whatnot. So the numbers are large. Not all of them are trained, and certainly most of the facilities are not up to the level where they can provide efficient health service.
We got to create a fit-for-purpose health system. I mean, people, the professionals who are there to deliver the services. So before we just like, oh, it does produce a lot of HR, but now we are saying, no, we need to have a kind of fit-for-purpose. I mean, if a doctor sort of be there, the doctor should be there. There's a specialist, there's a nurse, there's the midwife, everybody that makes the health system to grow. So those are some of the challenges we have in the system.
The pharmaceutical sector is confronted with many challenges, which include inadequate funding from government for the procurement, storage and distribution of medicines, acute shortage of trained dispensers, low number of supply chain management specialists, shortage of vehicles to transport drugs and insufficient standard storage facilities at county and national levels. The supply of drugs is irregular and not always available in health facilities across the county. Drug peddlers and medicine stores in both urban and rural communities are selling fake drugs without any punitive measures.
Well, presently we have about 96 Liberian pharmacists, and I will tell you, no, they are not in a bigger number to cover up, because as we speak, we have to each pharmacist, I mean to each county hospital, we have a pharmacist, and that is not sufficient, because to carry out better services, you need more than three pharmacists in each institution. For Montserrado County, the first thing is that government needs these people. So government will take the larger portion by sending first this trained manpower into its own institution, that is the public institution. And when that is completely done, then they can spill over to the private sector.
We're also looking at the system that delivers the drugs and supplies, and how we can strengthen that from the central down to the end user. We are looking at the governance and leadership system also. At the moment, we try to deconcentrate service delivery and functions to some extent, but we think for us to be able to respond to emergencies like this, or be able to respond adequately, there's a need for us to decentralize further, deconcentrate the functions further, and strengthen the district level teams to function better. So we are also re-looking at the structures and how we can strengthen them to be able to.
Liberia highly depends on donors to finance its health services, and Montserrado County receives the biggest chunk of such funding. Fees paid by citizens for health services in public facilities were suspended in 2006. Human Resource for Health, HRH, is essential to attaining coverage enhancements. The total number of clinical health workers increased from 1,396 in 1998 to 5,346 in 2010, according to the Ministry of Health, MOH, Health Census.
I'm going to work closely with the Ministry of Health, because if we in Montserrado County don't have health centers, then you imagine what those counties in the rural area, what they are going through. So it's the responsibility of government to make sure that it maintains these hospitals and provide qualified doctors and nurses. And that's why I'm appealing to the Todi citizens to send their children to school, and those who already have left and educated, try and come home. We have to look into our social benefits and try to build apartments that we did with some of the schools being built here for the nurses and doctors to have good living conditions, because you cannot come from the city and come here and live in a mud house and in a hut. It's not possible. But just seeing the facility, I show everything else with the cooperation and collaboration for government and Ministry of Health with the new minister. I'm sure there will be a lot of great things happening for the health center in Liberia over the years.
In Liberia, pre-service education refers to the preparatory training programs that health workers must complete in order to practice their profession. Reports have it that the number of mid-level cadres, particularly nurses, has doubled between 2006 and 2009, and the number of midwives is progressively increasing since 2000. The number of trained physicians has also increased from 15 to 30. As of February 2015, Montserrado County has 23 registered midwives, 208 certified midwives, 47 licensed practical nurses, 424 nurse aides, 576 nurses, BSc and RN, 149 physician assistants, and 66 medical doctors.
Currently in this hospital, we have about 328 health workers, and that number includes the medical staff and the supportive staff. The medical staff takes about 80% of that number. Currently, we have 43 beds, both floors, the ground floor, the maternal side, and then the pediatric, the second floor, 43 beds in total. And before the Ebola period, we were a hospital of 64 beds. But then we had to cut down because of the IPC protocol, the number of bed space and the meter between the bed space. So we had to cut it down and follow IPC protocol. So currently we are 43 bed hospital. Yes, we have essential drugs available. They're available at all times. Except for there are times when we have shortages, but that's for a minimum period until it can be procured or until our partners can come in.
Yeah, no, we have some PPE on us. Yes.
The 40 catheter, the gloves.
Injectable gloves.
All the IV.
Our
drugs are supplied in, I would say, three basic ways. The hospital receives subsidies from government. We are not a budget hospital. We don't get budget from government. So with the subsidy that we receive from government, we have a line in our budget that we allocate for procuring essential drugs. We also get essential drugs from the NDS to the Ministry of Health to the National Drug and Service. We get drugs from there too. And then our partners, we have our local partners and international partners, like the IRC, the Medicines and Frontier. They see the needs based upon our request, and they send essential drugs also to us. This hospital is free service. There is no charge attached to it. So every service rendered here is free. I have two opinions to this question in two ways I can answer it. Firstly, it's important that a woman who can afford pay at least some small fee to get her health service, you know, quality medical service. But then on the other hand, we live in a country that is a third world country. Some people can't even afford $1 per day. And according to what we have been giving, they have researched that most Liberians live under $1 US per day. And if you are going to offer quality health service to this woman, you know that it's going to be way beyond $1 per day. So the category of patients that come to us, the catchment area that we find ourselves in, a lot of the people can't afford for their own health service, they can't afford. So now it is working perfectly, but you know, based on the economy, you know, it's working. People can afford, they will come here and get the quality health service. But there will come a time when at least there will be some fee that has to be attached to it. Our in-house training, most times we collaborate, we coordinate it from the administrative level and then the medical staff. We have supervisors. So what we do is we have the medical staff that are to be trained. The supervisors, it would be the nursing supervisor or the nursing directress or the PA supervisors. Those are the two that oversee the nurses, the midwives, the aide, the medical staff. The exception of the doctor, they will come in and say, "Doc, oh, we think there's a need for, you know, certain refresher, you know, topics to go over and over, like newborn resuscitation. You got to keep, you know, refreshing it, refreshing their minds how to do it, like the use of oxygen. In a few days' time, we are going to have a refresher workshop on how the staff, how to use the oxygen, how to turn it on, how to turn it off, when to assess your patient's need for it, and all that. So when we get these topics, is presented to the medical director. She goes through these topics. Those that are responsible for presenting it, they are told, they get the topic set, the administration makes available whatever logistical needs there will be for the refresher workshop, and then it is carried out. The essential equipment I will start with, just my ER. Yeah, and then I climb up to the walls. Because the ER is where the patient intake comes from, the triage or the screening room. They come through the ER. From the ER, then we send them up on the walls. So in the ER, we got oxygen concentrators. There are about three of them there. We got like six beds in the ER. And this is more like one to a patient. And sometimes if we have the wire connector, the little valve that you connect, two or three patients can get on one concentrator, but most times the valve is not available. So because of the cost is an expensive thing, so now you just send one to a unit, one of the wire connectors. So there are times where we have to turn patients away because we don't have oxygen. It's not that it's not available, but the one that is here, other patients are on it. If this patient is child coming in, we need it. You know, we can't keep the patient here and we fighting all over the place, we have to refer you. So those are some of the things that we need. Oxygen concentrator. Secondly, we take in babies from 0 to 28. We take in children from 0 to 5 years old, up to 15 emergency cases. And with that, the warmers, where you put the baby, we don't have that here. The two that we have is in the NICU, the neonatal intensive care unit. That's just two we have. And sometimes we've got a problem with the electricity, it blows off. You got to get somebody, you know, look at it again and put it on. So with a hospital as big as this, you know, catering to so many children, you just have two warmers. That is, you know, something that we are short of. And then we come back to even with our bed space, although we have enough beds, but these are things that continuously as a hospital, you know, you have to turn them over. You can't have one bed you've been using for the past 6-7 years with the same mattress on it. And, you know, patient come after patient after patient after patient, you know, using the same thing. So with the ER, those are some of the concerns. And then we'll come to the maternity side where we take in our pregnant mothers. We also have need for oxygen there. There is a shortage for it. There's a need for it. We have our delivery beds, two of them are there, they were given to us by the Osiwa, the African Union, when they were here, they refurbished our maternity area for us. But again, it's like a wear and tear. Those are items, equipment that you use continuously so many times, and then it breaks down. Then you have need for more. Okay? Then, most importantly, an ultrasound machine. We run a hospital where we see a lot of, you know, pregnant mother, tender cases. We have a little small portable one that is much smaller than this microwave, which is not sufficient. We need a hospital mounted ultrasound that we can put somewhere, you know, and see a lot of cases from it. And we have an x-ray machine here. You know, that's one cool thing. The x-ray machine helps us a lot. And then in the OT, down to our operating theater, we have one anesthetic machine. And we have two theaters. We have the minor theater and we have the major theater. So we have only this anesthetic machine monitor that is in the major. In the minor room, when we're doing a case, they're doing surgery there, they will have to do the manual BP cuff and the pulse oximeter, which is not safe, you know, to use on a patient that you're putting through anesthesia. So those are some of the shortages that we have, equipment.
This is our hematology lab, where we do all the teamwork. For now, we are not doing microbiology. So all the microbiological specimen we get, we send it to LRBI. So we do the routine lab here. And this way, this is the blood bank. And we are doing a walking bank. We don't have national blood bank or blood bank. We are doing walking bank where relatives can donate for the patients. And then we serve the patients. Yeah. Here we do all screening for blood safety. Malaria, hepatitis B, RPR, syphilis. RPR, syphilis are the same thing. So we do the HIV as well. We refer a donor according to results. And we qualify a donor according to results. So blood is taken from donor and kept here for patient use. Lot of challenges here. Then most of the time, the women, you see women, we have to talk to women. 90% of the women that can come, they feel women are not to give blood. So we have to encourage them to really give blood for the patient. You can, and then on a trap level, that the Muslims and all of them are dingo. Fula, we can't say, no, I'm a Fula man. I don't give blood to my dingo man. We have to educate them that we can give blood to anybody. Once your blood is compatible, you can give. We are not doing chemistry. We are not doing CBC. The machines we got good machines here. We got a lot of machines, and then we are out of reagents. 90% of the machines here don't have reagent. Like here we got a piccolo, which is the chemistry machine. There's no cartridge in the country, and then getting cartridge is very expensive. So we recommend if we can get another chemistry machine that all chemistry hospitals here using, the machines that all hospitals using, then we can be able to use. That the dry chemistry machine, when you go GFK, yeah, there be all hospitals using, then we will not be faced with that. Then for here, we got a CBC machine, and big hospital that they're not doing CBC is a very big challenge. No CBC. So the doctor order gel, MS, and other things to just portion of the complete blood count. It's not completed. Yeah. There's the basement cutter, the big man cutter, and the big man cutter. All hospital here using big man cutter, but all the no reagents and the body machines. A year here after the first supply of reagent is the end of the whole work. Then we got another machine in there, the pigman. There's the pigman. You can see the pigment. Since the cartridge expired, since 2014, the cartridge expired up to present, we haven't gotten any cartridge. So the machine to not keep it in the past for it to stay and spoil, we have to keep putting it on. But there's no cartridge. We are not doing CBC in the hospital. So the big hospital is that we're only doing routine lab. Then another place here, you see this is a centrifuge. This is not hematocrit centrifuge, but we're using it for both hematocrit and tip. We don't have hematocrit centrifuge as or is a patient for us. We put the hematocrit here and spin it here just to get it ready. But we calibrated it instead of 3 minutes, we calibrated it to 5 minutes for the blood to set. So our recommendation is you take that to whatsoever you're going to the head and really recommend that the laboratory really need attention.
Okay.
JDJ laboratory need attention.
Our health system should be run like a business with the right tools and training, a properly functioning procurement and supply chain, proper financial and human resource management, good governance, monitoring and evaluation, and sound information systems.
We are discussing the possibility of a national public health institute that is semi-detached from the Ministry of Health, semi-detached so that the government will be able to support it with its own budget, a system that has the control and command system from up straight down to the community level. We're also looking at the laboratory systems and the network of laboratories that support the Public Health Institute and the work and how we can strengthen them. Originally, we had plans to do like 5 regional hospitals. And so at the moment we are looking, we have done some assessment for those regions, regional hospitals, laboratories, to see how we can start building the laboratory component for both clinical work and the public health work, in addition to the National Public Health Reference Laboratory that we have. So that exercise also is ongoing. We are designing the whole system along with our partners, and then mobilizing the resources that are required to support that.
You know, I saw the preliminary documentary, I think it's very good. It had listed out the key challenges, and it is now upon the policymakers to make sure that, you know, the issues that, you know, have been highlighted in the documentary is now to take it forward. So you have the issues, you got the problems, how to find a solution to it. And I think that is a key moving forward. So our responsibility now is to take this, the documentary to Wahoo. These are the issues. Now we have identified them. How can we move forward? How do we raise resources? Where do you come in? You know, how can the government help? Because this is very independent and very professionally done. And it's one of the best, you know, research work I've seen. It's very good. So, and I'm happy I was part of it. And, you know, we'll continue to be part of it. You know, the next stage, the next level, what we can do from our side in pushing Wahoo to get support to the network to do other things for help. So that's something I will be working on.